Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Wow.
Good evening.
Good evening.
That's a great presentation.
Thank you for the opportunity to be here and close up our study on integrated planning for school and community. My name is Michael Miller. I'm program manager for the Operations Research and Education Lab at NC State. My colleague is Tom Cook. He conducted land use interviews last fall, and we're here tonight to talk about some of the data behind this, some of the demographic and land use data that generates membership forecasts for the school district.
Good information.
The contract and scope of work for this project was a comprehensive analysis of regional and local factors that influence student population. So the analysis using GIS data, historical data, statistics, and land use data all combines for a forecast membership for forecast over the next 5 to 10 years. There's three major tasks in this study: a land use study that was conducted, the interviews were conducted last fall, a student membership forecast, and the creation of a planning segment database which allows demographic and boundary attendance boundary analysis. Some background statistics before we get going. Student populations are a little bit different than general populations in that we can actually track how students migrate through the system from year to year. We have solid numbers, and we know how a student cohort can age through the system. But if we do look at some of the county data, we see that the county population is now projected to grow at a rate of about 0.5% over the next 5 years. The distribution of the population through the municipalities is shown in that pie graph. Another set of statistics: if you look at how the breakdown of the population by age occurs, comparing Beaufort County to the rest of the state, there's a very interesting thing on the last half of this graph. If you look at for ages from 55 to 100 plus, you'll notice that those columns are larger than the statewide averages. So generally speaking, the population for the county can be considered a little older than for the state. About 19% of the population is in the county is of school age, and about 21% of the population of the state is of school age. This is additional census data for owner-occupied housing units, about 2.38 persons per household, and for rental occupied housing units, about 2.35 persons per household. Once again, that's from the 2010 census. As we drill down a little bit finer into the school statistics, this is a graph of month one membership, average daily membership, for the period from 2007 through 2012. And you see a clear decreasing trend there. The bump in this current year, actually, when we got into the analysis, it's probably not so much a bump for this current year as an excessive drop in 2011-12. So if you actually look at these 7 years, it's a fairly flat, slightly decreasing trend from 07 to current data. Drilling down a little bit finer to look at the historical trends per school, this table shows us for the years 2009 through 2012, the membership. Remember, this is month one ADM. Yes, sir.
Question. On this chart in the bottom right, it shows 6789 in the historic trends 2013-2012, and on the last chart it shows 7011. What's the difference there?
If you look at the bottom of this table, those two alternative special schools, Beaufort County Early College and BC EdTech, are not included in these counts. So if you add that 187, you get back to where that number was.
To 7,000?
Yeah. Thank you. So at this point, we'd like to talk a little bit about the land use studies, the interviews that were conducted last fall. And the reason we do a land use study is it gives us a better idea of how, when growth occurs, different communities are impacted throughout the county. So even if you have an idea of how the system as a whole is going to grow, the land use studies help us quantify where that growth is going to occur over the next 5 to 10 years. The stakeholders and communities' perceptions are validated through GIS analysis. So we're able to download parcel and subdivision analysis from the GIS database and use that to compare with the findings from the land use study. And all of this goes into an articulation of the growth that we expect over the next 5 to 10 years. At this point, I'll let Tom come up and talk about the interviews.
Thank you, Mike. Next slide, please. I did come to Beaufort County last September and spent several days, September 4th through the 6th, conducting interviews with a variety of stakeholders from throughout Beaufort County. We talked with planners representing the county as well as local municipalities. We spoke with economic development folks, Chamber of Commerce, I believe, also. We also looked at some of the factors that encourage or constrain growth. We talked with folks representing supporting infrastructure, in other words, NCDOT, to get a perspective on transportation improvements that were either in place, planned, or under construction, and also utility folks to get an idea of supporting water and sewer infrastructure and changes that might be anticipated in that. We look at industrial and commercial development that might be underway or might be anticipated. We also look at, most importantly for generating school students, residential development. And I'm going to talk very briefly about some of the highlights from the land use study interviews. One thing is that while Beaufort County has grown, that growth has been relatively slow when compared to North Carolina statewide. And that has held true for the past several years. That trend is expected to continue into the future. So again, while there is growth, it's at a rate that is a little bit lower than what the state as a whole has been experiencing. One of the factors that draws people to Beaufort County is its proximity to Greenville, and that has encouraged folks to settle, particularly in western Beaufort County, in the areas around Washington and Chocowinity. And there's convenient access to commute to workplaces in Greenville or Pitt County from Beaufort County. We found no concerns regarding water supply. There's an adequate water supply for the present and anticipated into the future, so that's not a constraint. We did find that several of the industries in the county, and again, this was back in last September, and I'm not sure how things may have changed since that time, but this represents a snapshot from last September, that several industries had reduced their workforce. An example was Potash Corps had reduced its workforce at that time or shortly before then by about 150. We also heard that some of the boat building companies were experiencing some hard times as a result of the recession. On the residential construction or development front, we heard that the size of residential subdivisions had decreased, that the size had gone down to about 20 to 80 lots in a typical subdivision. In the previous years, the size of subdivisions had been somewhat larger in some cases. We found that Washington had not experienced a substantial amount of population growth since 2000. It had experienced some population growth. Most of that was concentrated to the west of the city. We found that Chocowinity was growing. Several representatives that we spoke with, or stakeholders that we spoke with, said that as a result of convenient access by North Carolina Highway 33, that Chocowinity was a location that was experiencing residential development, particularly from folks that were working and commuting to Greenville. In terms of the western side of the county versus the eastern side of the county, we really heard two different stories. We heard that while the western side of the county was experiencing some population growth, that the eastern side of the county had actually experienced a decline in population. Some of that was attributable to impacts from Hurricane Irene in 2011 that had really devastated several communities in eastern Beaufort County, and they really were struggling and had not recovered from that and had experienced some loss of population. And finally, we heard that Bath had attracted several retirees, and they had been attracted to areas on or very near the water, whereas younger families were more likely to settle in the inland area because of land costs, land and housing costs. So that is a very brief overview of some of the highlights from those land use interviews that we used when looking at the data. At this point, I'm going to turn things back over to Mike.
Thanks. I would remind you that you should have in your packets the complete land use study final report dated April 24. So all of this information and a whole lot more detail is available in that report. The second part of a land use study is the analysis, where we attempt to quantify the perceptions that Tom spoke of. And in particular, we look at parcel records through GIS analysis, looking at residential and developed subdivision parcels, projected developments, and something called the student generation ratio, which is one of the more important outcomes of a study like this. It enables us to look at how potential developments can generate students and where they will be impacting the school district. So if you can see those little rose-colored spots on the map here, those are some of the residential developments that could potentially impact school populations. Once again, as Tom mentioned, we're looking primarily at the western side of the county here. And what I'd like to do now is take you through a couple examples of where we have seen growth through the data. And we're primarily looking at the period of two consecutive school years, 2011-12 to 2012-13. And the numbers you see here on the right side of this table are the K-12 student counts in a particular planning segment. We'll talk more about planning segments in a moment. So there are 20 on this list, representing about 20% of the student population, K-12 student population in the county. And the gains in membership that we see in these planning segments offset some of the losses that we may have seen in other places. So even though we're talking about a system-wide forecast that may not be increasing or increasing very fast, that does not mean some of the areas in the county are not growing. For example, if we look at planning segment IDs 177 and 178, there's a mobile home park there, River Road Mobile Home Park, increasing from 33 to 69 K-12 students in the course of one consecutive school year. Pirate Crow, Cove just increased by two, but they're adjacent planning segments. Alderbrook Apartments, segment 156, increased from 69 to 94 in two consecutive years. And this isn't really a subdivision per se, but the area in Washington near some of the schools, we also saw a dramatic increase there of about 50% for planning segments 165 and 166. Cypress Bluff, Cypress Corner, Cypress Landing also showed signs of growth, increasing from 73 to 82 students. And when you stand back and look at some of the areas of growth throughout the county, this map represents what we call a heat map, which is planning segments that have grown over that two-year span. And the redder the color that you see, the more students grew during that period. The reddest is from 21 to 40, and all the way down to losses of 42 to 20, where you see darker green. And this is the same picture, but for the entire county. Now, I mentioned student generation ratio. That's one of the more important statistics that a study like this can generate. And basically what we do is we look at the number of developed parcels, residential parcels, and count how many students are there. So for a particular subdivision having 12 parcels and 4 students, the student generation ratio is a third. So here's some examples of representative developments throughout the county. This one is Smallwood, which is planning segments 159 and 162. In this neighborhood, there's 475 developed parcels and 133 K-12 students, which equates to a student generation ratio of 0.28 students per developed parcel. Why is this number important? Because when a comparable subdivision is developed somewhere in the county, this can give you an idea of impact for schools that will serve this community. Cypress Landing, segment 198. 800 developed parcels as of the time of the analysis. About 80 students there, so you're talking about a much lower student generation ratio for this particular planning segment, about one-tenth student per developed parcel. Now, this is not a subdivision or a development per se. This is planning segment 120, just to give you an idea of how different areas of the county react for student generation purposes. There's 200 developed parcels here, generating about 60 students. So this area actually has a higher potential to develop students per developed parcel than some of the subdivisions at 0.3 students per developed parcel. And planning segment 139 is Northgate. The student generation rate here is about 0.42 students per developed parcel. If you look at the county as a whole, we generally see between 0.3 and 0.4. I would caution against using a single number to generate student generation for the whole county, because as you can tell from these examples, it depends on where you are. Now, as we move into the membership forecast, what we do first is try to look at how the system as a whole behaves, how students are advancing through the system from K, from kindergartner, all the way through 12th grade. Look at those historical trends. Combine those with the land use study data, the things that you've just been looking at. And that's how we get the membership forecast. A key element in this is the resident live birth data. So for the last 10 or so years here, from 2003 through 2012, this data represents the number of county resident live births for that particular year. And just like many counties in North Carolina, we are seeing a decreasing trend, especially since about 2008-2009. This is a very common profile for counties throughout the state. What this means is, if you count ahead, it doesn't mean all 604 children born in this county will become kindergartners, but it is a good representation of the kind of dynamics between the county population and the school population. So if you look at how many children were born 5 years ago that enter the school as kindergartners, that ratio remains more or less stable. And what we're seeing here is a decrease over the last 5 years. And as in many North Carolina counties, that data-wise tells us without significant in-migration, we should not see strong trends in kindergarten influx over the next few years.
Does this pick up births in hospitals in surrounding counties who live in this county?
The number does, because the number doesn't know where they're coming from. What the number does is compares how many kindergartners show up on month one, to how many are born in the county. So for example, if that number is larger than one, that means the county is experiencing influx from other places. So yes. Current declining trends in birth rates and in migration, system-wide membership over the next 1 to 5 years suggests a slight decrease in overall K-12 students, with more or less flat in K-5 to 6-8, elementary to middle school, and a slight increase in high school membership. So once again, this is system-wide. We're not looking at individual schools yet. There are pockets of growth and pockets of negative growth in the county, but this is a system-wide model. And from the period 2007 to 2012, we saw a minus 0.35% annual growth rate for K-12. And that translates into a pretty much flat growth rate over the next 5 years of about minus 0.06%. That's considered flat. Now, once again, what we are showing here, I kind of deleted part of this graph, the resident live birth trend that you saw just a little while ago. Right now, it's declining. And we think that unless significant in-migration comes in, that trend will govern some of these near-term numbers. If that trend reverses, or if there's significant in-migration into the system, we would expect to see more of an upturn on the latter end of this forecast. So the reliability of any kind of forecast without in-migration data starts to get a little fuzzy after 5 or so years. So we would look at this as more of a 1 to 5 year forecast.
Can I clarify something? The rate of birth, are you talking about the location of the baby's address or where the baby was born in the hospital?
In the hospital. Yes.
Okay. We have a lot of folks that go to Pitt County and have their babies, and then they live in Beaufort County. How do you?
Well, that's right. The number takes into account. Let's say that how big is the kindergarten class? Let me give you a specific example. If I can.
Well, I guess one of the questions is, how do you bring those numbers back into Beaufort County? In other words, where's your data source when you
data use source is from the state data office about resident live births. So the way this works is there may only be 500 children born in this county, but the number that we use to multiply to find kindergartners is bigger than one. That means that there's people coming in from out of the county to go to school here.
That's not what we're asking. What we're asking is, there is a significant number of population in Beaufort County who live here but go to Pitt County to have their baby because of the tertiary care center.
Mm-hmm. And Craven County.
And even Craven County. So does it take, when you're talking about how many births are occurring in Beaufort County, are you taking into account those births that are carrying at other counties?
Yes, yes, yes. The cohort number, oh, it takes that into account. Yes, absolutely.
It's births to Beaufort County residents.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the way the database works? Births to Beaufort County residents?
Yes, county resident live births. Yes,
county
sir.
County resident live births.
County resident
regardless
live
of where
births.
The baby is
yes.
born.
Yes, yes. County resident.
Okay.
Yes, county resident live births. Yes. And the cohort number takes all that into account anyways. It's not following individual students. What it's looking at is the cohort as a whole. So it's saying the population is this large for this year, but we want to know how that impacts kindergartners. You could have every one of those children.
How do you find those live births from the other county? It would be a birth certificate would be issued in Pitt County.
Mm-hmm.
How do you find
census?
That once again, the cohort number already takes that into account.
How do you handle Hispanic births?
just like any others. They're not separated by race.
I know, but where do you get your data from?
It's from the same data source.
All right, what about people moving into the county? You know, you have a lot of transfer in, transfer out.
That's correct.
All kind of stuff, so.
That's what the cohort number does. It looks at how the system has behaved 5 years ago and projects what's going to happen in 5 years in the future.
Okay.
Now, it can't tell you that every identical student that was born here is going to end up in kindergarten here, but it doesn't need to. What we need to know is the general trend of the numbers.
Gotcha.
Okay?
You continue.
Thank you.